Last year, I reviewed another Linux laptop. This year, I'm reviewing the Tuxedo Infinitybook Pro 14 Generation 6. It is absolutely one of the most gorgeous laptops I've had the pleasure of dealing with. So with that, let's open this bad boy up and show you the desktop. So there's a lot of options that you can choose from when you order your Tuxedo laptop. Now, these laptops aren't cheap. We'll go over that here in a second, as they're more of a business class laptop. This one actually got sent to me and preloaded, and of course, me being me, the first thing I did was wipe it out. And this was a pretty cool one, and I'll go over towards the end of the video how I did this. But here was all the options I could restore it with using their custom tool called WebFay, otherwise known as Web Fully Automated Installer. And you can do Tuxedo OS, which I think is a Budgie-based Ubuntu. And then there's a regular Ubuntu, Ubuntu Budgie, Kubuntu, Xbuntu, which is XFCE, Mate. And then there's a whole bunch of other ones as well, which I thought was pretty darn cool. And I ended up just going with Kubuntu. I like a KDE, and it's very predictable. Here's what it comes pretty much preloaded. I loaded up a couple different customizations here, like Moonlight and Brave, as I have been playing some games and some other stuff on it. But I just kind of want to show you this. Now, this is a 1080p resolution, which actually, by stock defaults, this actually runs at a higher resolution, a 3K resolution, which is 2800 by 1800, which I'll touch here in a second. For the screen caps, I wanted to kind of show you a couple things before we zoom out here and kind of show the hardware. First off, I was pleasantly surprised by this Tuxedo Control Center. There was a lot of things that you could control and set. It really reminded me a lot of really amazing utilities that Windows comes with, but Tuxedo knows what they're doing here, and they've done a great job kind of putting this in a form factor. I almost want to transplant this to other laptops I have just to see what if it's able to read it or not. I think that would be pretty cool because I love how this is laid out, the different profiles, if it's plugged in or if it's on battery, what happens to it, what happens to the fan control. You can change all these things. So if it's plugged in, it's not. Right now I'm running on battery power for this presentation. And one more unique thing before we get out of this, and I'll just kind of show you the laptop, what it looks like in its standard stock 3K mode when we're not doing screen mirroring, is when you do like an apt update, one thing I noticed here, which I thought was kind of interesting, was these right here, these servers, they're all coming from Tuxedo computers. And Tuxedo computers, these mirrors are located in Europe. So whenever I do an update, I did notice it is a bit slower. And I actually talked and contacted them after getting this review unit. And I was like, hey, I noticed these are a little bit slower, as you see on the other side, about 1 to 2 megabytes per second, depending on the package. Some are a little bit faster, some are a little bit slower. But I did notice a little bit of a decrease. And when I looked at how long it's taking to, let's say, the latency behind it when there's multiple files, you're seeing about 150 milliseconds of latency because the servers are so far away from me. I'm pretty much on the other side of the world. So I thought this was interesting. I did say, are you going to add US-based mirrors? And they did get back to me and say sometime in the future they are planning to add US-based mirrors. But it is one downside I wanted to point out, and you can't just change these to the stock Ubuntu mirrors because they do curate the drivers and the packages in here to where you're not going to get a bad NVIDIA driver. You're not going to get a bad update for the hardware that's in these machines. So when you're doing these upgrades, you don't have to worry as much because they've already tested them on your hardware. And that's where a lot of Linux updates go bad, is they're just not familiar. You know, they can't make everything 100% compatible with all the hardware out there, where when you curate your own server like Tuxedo has done here, you don't have to worry so much about that because they know what hardware you're using. And when you're getting these updates, you always get a good update, which is pretty cool. So I thought that was a neat little tidbit, but something I thought is a little bit of a double-edged sword. Obviously, you don't have as fast mirrors, especially if you're over here in the States. If you're over in, I think Germany is where these, I think, are hosted, or in the Europe region, you're going to get a lot faster downloads than what you just saw right here.
I did notice, you can see the screen. This is the 1080p that you're seeing that I was using for mirroring. Let me just change this real fast so we can actually see what the 4K screen is. And it's this 2880 by 1800 is the stock. And it looks gorgeous. Obviously, I didn't know. I noticed there was no scaling or anything that needs to happen. And also, I noticed the brightness can get like crazy bright, like so bright I have to adjust the ISO on my screen. But like right here looks pretty darn good on my eyes. And that's probably around a 30 or 40% brightness. I'll boot into Windows 2 so you can see that as well. So it's a 400 nit screen, which is extremely bright. Probably the brightest laptop I've done. Even in direct sunlight, I had no issues getting this thing readable or checking anything as far as that. So probably one of the prettiest screens I've ever had. And I noticed when I kind of punching around in KDE here, I noticed everything was just kind of readable perfectly. I thought I was going to have a lot of issues with this aspect of it, but just on regular Kubuntu here, I noticed I didn't have any issues reading anything. I saw just great readability. So this screen is probably one of the best screens I've ever had, and I've had a lovely time as it's a very, very light notebook. Probably one of the lightest ones I had. I usually have a war machine with me that I don't particularly like taking for traveling, but for this is a perfect traveling PC. Also, I noticed on the touchpad here, you can see there's this little button and you can tap it, and then it disables the mouse pad. So then when you're typing, if you're doing any kind of blogging, whatever it might be, you're not going to accidentally hit it with your thumb, and then all of a sudden your mouse goes anywhere, and you just double tap it again to get going. That's pretty awesome for the big, I mean, that's a large mouse pad, which is very, very nice. So I've loved this mouse pad. The only downside I have to say about it, no gesture support. So there's no gestures, so you can't do like three fingers to move between like maybe a virtual desktop or two. Not really a big deal for me, as I really like my regular just hotkeys through the keyboard, as I'm not a big mouse user. But I thought the double tap right here was pretty ingenious to disable the mouse pad. I had them dual boot, and one downside to the dual boot I noticed was they put everything on the same drive, which I thought was going to be a problem because it shipped with Windows 10 Home to me. And I went ahead and said, well, let's go ahead and update it to Windows 11, see what happens. I figured it would break the bootloader, but it didn't. And I ended up not liking the bootloader it came with, and I did my own little bootloader project. If you're interested in doing like a custom bootloader like this, I made a simple install script so you can put this on your system if you like, if you do dual boot Linux and Windows. But for now, you could just use the stock one that it comes with. It's a bit ugly. That's why I switched it around. So I'm going to just log in here. I encrypted my grub, as this is a laptop, and if someone stole it from me, I don't want them having access to my stuff. By stock default, it does not come with an encrypted grub that I saw. But you can always encrypt your drive, and I do recommend that just in case someone does get your laptop. They're not going to be able to grab your files off there if it's not encrypted. Let's log in. So this is Windows 11, obviously, and had no issues with it. I did do a full upgrade. This didn't come from the factory from them. I upgraded to Windows 11 with it, and I was surprised that it didn't wipe out the bootloader, which is kind of funny. Didn't see any issues with anything here. It does have that control center that we talked about in Linux. They also have one directly here for Windows. Now, this right here is actually set in German. They are a German-based company, and since I think this was actually tested before sending to me, but for those English customers, they will ship this in English. I just haven't bothered to change this around here. I've done power mode. I've tried performance, balanced, a couple other ones here. I do recommend using their utility, though, if you're going to use Control Center. I highly recommend coming in here. They have their own profiles. Like, this is just saying limit the fan speed to 40 decibels, or you could put it in performance mode. They have enthusiast mode. You could do over boost. It just depends on what you want to do. I did try performance mode with over boost, and this right here is fan boost. Now, whenever you do the fan boost, you can hear those fans just kick off. I hate that. Obviously, we don't need to do fan boost, and I'd probably just leave it on enthusiast. And frankly, I kind of like the more passive mode, because if I'm going to do any kind of hardcore gaming, I'm usually using like Moonlight to do so. A good example is I did install like Diablo 2 on this just to see how it plays, because this does come with a 2050 Ti. So I'm going to go ahead and launch into this. So for this, you can kind of see this right here. I would say on battery power, this looks like it's getting about 10 frames or so, maybe 15 frames. And I think this is actually pretty normal for a lot of like business style minimal laptops, as when you do this and you're pulling it from battery, it's going to throttle it back. You can see a little bit blocky. You see the latency there. So yeah, you're going to be getting about that 10 frames per second or so. However, let me go ahead and plug this in and you'll see how it does when it's actually pulling directly from wall power. All right, here we go. I'm going to plug the power in. And then you'll see, now that that card, that 2050 Ti, is getting all the power, now I'm getting able to get that 60 frames, and it becomes a very smooth experience. I thought this was kind of an interesting, whenever you have these really light, thin laptops. So this right here, though, plays very, very nice, very smooth. And we can just pull up like Cold Flame Planes or something like that. I don't know about playing this on... on here. Oh, yeah, playing Diablo on a mouse pad is not recommended, but very smooth. I at least wanted to show a little bit of gameplay for just your day-to-day workhorse portable laptop. I think this is just a fantastic laptop, one that I'm going to be using in bed and just kind of bringing around to places if I had to go to a conference or something like that. This right here, you just really can't beat this configuration, and it's right in the same price point as many like Lenovo laptops in the same generation. You might have a little bit of an upcharge depending on the sales and things being run, but overall I have absolutely loved this machine, and the fact that it's fully Linux compatible makes it worthwhile for me, as I hate anything that's not dual bootable. And also, you can't just take it and pop it open. You can see you don't need any special tools. It's just about 7 screws to open this up. Intake air is here. Exhaust is right here. And it's a great design. It looks like a Clevo laptop design in a more portable form factor with a beautiful logo on the front.